The most important skill we have next to our ears, hearing music, and our ability to technically, you know, play what we want to, is our sense of rhythm. But in order to perform rhythm guitar parts accurately that are comfortable to us and get them feeling like they're very well controlled, especially when we're considering the timing that we're delivering in a song, we need to have a solid approach to performing rhythmic meter. Now, without it, we're going to have problems with matching up to the rhythm guitar parts from songs and with being able to perform rhythms perfectly in time. Another problem you'll have is creating your own original rhythm guitar parts when you're composing your own songs. So in this video, I want to cover a collection of techniques that you can take in and use right away to build much better skills at helping you play better rhythm guitar. Well, in taking a very serious look at rhythm guitar studies, I have four ideas that I want to introduce to you, and I really hope that you take these seriously, and you know, I hope they make a difference in your playing. The first idea I want to introduce to you is just counting in. So few people do it. I'm always surprised, you know, when I'm working with different students of, you know, how many people just kind of avoid the count in, and you know, there'll be some kind of groove that we're going to work on, and they're like, okay, yeah, well, let's do it. 1, 2, 3, and four, and it's, you know, in no time at all, they're kind of off the beat, and you know, they're kind of dropping the beat, and things aren't going very well for them. So counting in makes a huge difference. So you know, let's say you're going to do a groove, and maybe we'll just use a G major chord here, and if you count in 1, 2, 3. 3, 4. Right away, you know where that beat is, you know where you're supposed to jump in time, and it makes a pretty big difference. Now, if you have a metronome running, that's even better. And if you take it to the next level and count in with a little bit of emotion, you know, a little bit of connectiveness to what's going on, you're going to play better, and it's really going to, you know, hammer out for you. So let's do that. Let's count in like we mean it, you know, with some emotion. 1, 2, 3, 4. That makes a big difference. You know, when you count in with some emotion and you put some grit into things like that, you know, I mean, it just makes you play better. You know where everything is better. You stay more consistent. It just affects everything with your rhythm guitar. So counting in like you mean it, it makes a big, big difference. Now, the second point that I want to bring up here is just simply consistency. With what's going on and, you know, how you're approaching your playing, that you're staying as consistent as you possibly can. You know, don't vary parts. I mean, you know, a lot of times I've worked with people where there's a part that's really important to a piece that we're working on, and what happens is, you know, they don't really play it. You know, they might play it once. You know, let's establish a part. Let's say we got a C major chord, and our part is going to go, you know, eighth notes and quarter notes back to back, and then, you know, into the end of, let's say, a second measure, we're going to have a half note. So something like this. 1 and 2, 3 and 4. 1 and 2, 3, 4. So let's say we're doing that. You know, that's our part. So, you know, they might do it for a while, but then all of a sudden they're changing it. You know, they're doing something different. Maybe they're even throwing some arpeggio stuff and finger picking stuff. And, you know, it's just like, whoa, man, if you're working with a, you know, somewhat, you know, intermediate level singer, you're probably going to really mess them up. You know, you're going to cause them to blow it on your gig, you know. So consistency is huge, you know, especially if you're doing recording a lot of times too. So when you start into a part, you know, really check with your bandmates, check with the people that you're working with if it's okay, you know, at some point to maybe add a run or a fill in, you know. You know, maybe it's okay to do it, maybe it's not. Maybe it's going to blow the whole band's perspective of what's happening at that moment. So, you know, if there's a part that you should keep very consistent, perhaps you better do that, you know, and keep the rest of the band on track instead of throwing everybody off by, you know, adding your own inventions in every, I don't know, 8 or 10 or 12 beats. It might not go over well in the band. So consistency is a huge one for rhythm guitar. Invent a part, keep the part solid. If you're doing a cover of a song, agree with your band what that part's going to be and stick to it. Now, the next thing I want to bring up, you know, we were talking about it a little bit ago, a few minutes ago, but is using a click track, using a metronome, drum machine, you know, something to really keep your beat in time. You know, let's say you've got a part and it has to be consistent. You know, maybe it's, I don't know, we'll take an A minor chord here and we'll do a consistent rhythm of quarter notes, eighth notes, quarter note, eighth note, and then maybe in the next measure we'll have a stream of eighth notes on the first two beats, 1 and 2 and then, I don't know, maybe a couple quarter notes after that. So if we have our click track going and we're really listening to all the punches that have to happen across those quarter notes and eighth notes, you know, we'll really keep them well organized and in time. But you know, if the metronome's off, you know, there's always a chance for the feel of the rhythm to kind of go, you know, like in a wave, it's kind of going to go up and go down, and it's not going to be very, you know, smooth. So let's say we do it without a metronome at first here. That's okay, but it just, you know, it seems like, you know, we're sort of fighting for the beat all the time. If I put a metronome on, you can take the 1 second out to flick the metronome on. 1, 2, 3, 4. You know, you start really paying attention to where that click is, you know, where your downbeats are, where the backbeats are, you know, how the next measure rolls in. All of a sudden with that click on, you're really focusing too on other elements like dynamics, and, you know, how's the playing staying, you know, in different kinds of consistency with the groove, you know, where's the beat at all the time, how's my meter, you know, with a click there, or even better with a drum machine on, you know, you can really focus on your overall playing and the, you know, how aware you are to have proper feel. So keep this idea in mind. If you've never used a looper pedal with a click track, I highly suggest trying that out, because when you have a looper pedal and you're using your click track to be able to establish those loops with it, your loops are going to be so rock solid. Now, if you've never used a loop pedal and you have no idea what I'm talking about, maybe one day soon you'll get a looper pedal and you can start experimenting with a click track in the background of setting up your loops. If you have a looper pedal now and you've never turned on a click track to establish the loops that you're layering, do it. You're going to find a big difference in how those loops are established on your pedal. Now, the last point I want to bring up here is really about establishing grooves and keeping them very consistent and very lasting, and especially, this is the big factor here, is not dropping your beat. And, you know, sometimes when you have a nice progression that sort of splits up string sets and so forth, that idea of, you know, keeping that beat really on track is a huge element. So what I'm going to do is I have invented this little riff here where I'm going to move from A minor, and I'm just going to split up my hits here a little bit, where I've got sort of low end and upper end of the chord. I'm going to go A minor to C into a G chord. You notice how I'm splitting the chord up a little bit, and then the last one's going to be D minor. Go back to A minor, C, and then we're going to go E minor, and then G major. Okay, so I'm going to play this with the metronome on. I'm going to really stay with the lasting groove and that impression and not drop the beat. All right, here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4. So there you have it. You know, when you're working within your timing, when you're playing to a click, when you're doing your count-ins, when you're focusing on consistency and really getting that idea together of keeping a lasting groove, not dropping the beat, all of a sudden what happens is your rhythm playing, your sense of dynamics, your sense of meter, everything is just going to change dramatically. You're going to have such better focus with your rhythm guitar. Everybody is going to be phoning you. They're all going to want to play with you. You're going to be busy as all heck and making tons of money in your local scene, because everybody loves having a fantastic rhythm guitar player in their band. Really solid rhythm guitar technique and just having great rhythm skills overall will ultimately revolve around you developing a great sense of feel and timing. So if you can't do things like count into a song properly with your band, or if you're having troubles carrying on a really solid, consistent beat, or if you can't play to a click track, or performing a groove over and over in time has you dropping the beat, you've probably got some rhythm playing problems that you're going to need to overcome, and this will involve isolated work on your rhythm guitar skills. Over time, the ideas I've covered here will really help to get you started, and with more study, you're going to find yourself getting better and better at keeping solid, consistent beats and timing and everything that you do. Well, thanks for joining me for this video. I hope you liked it. If you'd like to find out more about what you should be learning next on guitar, take a look at the courses on my website at creativeguitarstudio.com. My step-by-step beginner, intermediate, and advanced courses will cover what you need to know, along with how to be able to move forward and become the best guitar player that you can be. The courses and electives I've developed on the website will show you how everything fits together, and best of all, they'll help you identify gaps in your knowledge that are probably holding you back from becoming the best player possible. You know, for a lot of guitar players, there's always some missing piece of the puzzle, you know, something that is a key insight that's probably missing right now. And once you learn it, the floodgates open and you can continue moving forward and improving your guitar playing. You know, I've worked on these courses for a long time. I first started designing them in 1992, and I feel that over all these years and with all my private students I've developed them with, I've put together something that is really what I feel is the best guitar program that you'll ever find. Now, the courses are going to help you to mainly identify what's required to get you up to the next levels of guitar playing in a very organized way that just makes sense. So I look forward to helping you further your skills at creativeguitarstudio.com. Until next time, take care, and we'll catch up again on the next video. Bye for now. I've got 25 years experience teaching guitar and have written a well-organized step-by-step guitar course. Head over to my website at creativeguitarstudio.com and sign up for a free membership today. Join the thousands of members worldwide who have already enrolled. There's no need to try learning the guitar on your own. Let me help you become the best guitar player that you can be.